So this is just a couple pictures that show you how we, again, we really focus on trying to sample larvae and not just the adults, but the larvae. And so here's a couple colleagues sorting tadpoles. And the best way to do it, go ahead, is the plate and, oh, my text is being cut off, the plate and the spoon method. If you just get a plate and put your tadpoles in there and use a spoon, you can sort them according to species really quickly. Go ahead. And we like to photograph them and take a couple different views, dorsal and ventral, so you can get the live colors or the colors right after after they've been sacrificed. So we have good colors of these animals in life before they're preserved. And here's a couple more pictures of people. You know, in this case, we have multiple people preparing specimens of snake and then also swabbing frogs for chytrid. And here's a day where at the end of a long day, we sort of do a conveyor belt or a group effort where one person might be preparing specimens, another person might be taking notes, another person might be swabbing for chytrid fungus, one person might be measuring the specimens before we put them in there, before we inject them and preserve them, another person might be taking a critical data from them, the snout vent length of the frogs and the lizards. So if we divide the work up so that different people are doing different tasks, it becomes less onerous and we can share in the process. And we just like to have everybody do some of everything, once again. And then we can also share tricks that we've learned in special techniques, like, for example, how would you sample the liver of a turtle? Right? That's not a, if you sort of think about it, how many people here have sampled the liver from a turtle? How do you get into a turtle, right? It's enclosed in this bony box, and how do you get inside of it? Well, I can show you if we collect any turtles. There's a couple tricks to it. And there's these types of moments where we have an opportunity to teach people specialized techniques for sampling some of the tissue samples. And then for photography, some of it can be a challenge. And here's just an example. I just put this turtle up. You know, to get a photograph of a turtle with its head out, you have to sort of sit around for 15 minutes and wait till it pulls its head out of the shell, right? So there's a lot of things that you have to do that end up taking a lot of time. Keep going. Here's a photograph of a water skink of the genus Herpetofaunal in life. And this is one that is afraid of me, so it's turning away from me all the time. And every time you position the animal on a rock, it immediately turns to run away from you. So I have a lot of pictures of this thing running away from me, not the picture that I was hoping for. But in the process, you know, if there's something about the animal that's different and you didn't know it, this is a great place to document that this species in particular has a bright red ventral coloration. And I didn't know that because you couldn't see that in preserved specimens. But through the process of trying to take photographs, you might see something that's a very important character. And stopping the process and taking close-up photographs is always good. And then lastly, when it comes to photography, we try to do things like carry a point-and-shoot camera around with us, just so that we can, when we find something, an animal, before we capture it and put it in a plastic bag and then take it back to take it back to camp and set up a photography studio where we can get a nice picture of it, we try to take pictures of them in life, how we encounter them. And one of the reasons why we like to do that is, first, you get this picture of the frog in its natural position and its natural posture, but you can also capture things like behavior. Here's a male calling the females, and you can see it's extending its vocal sac. It's in the process of calling, and if you bring a camera around with you, you get a lot more natural photographs that are pretty handy. And you can record its habitat, and so I didn't know this species, for example, is found exclusively in these arboreal ferns. They were way up in trees, and once we figured it out, then we knew how to capture the species. Here's how you see them. They're always perched on tops of those leaves. But in the process of just running around, sort of sampling all the different microhabitat types, we learned this information about where the species actually occurs. It was formerly considered to be really rare. Turns out it's super common. You just have to climb up the tree and look in the fern. And if you do, you find them in these beautiful perched positions. And that photograph is important to me because it says something about how that animal actually occurs in its environment and where you can naturally find it. And then you can also, if you get lucky, happen upon something like this. Here is, my text got cut off again. Here is breeding amphibians of two species that had never been seen before in Amplexus, and no one knew where they laid their eggs. And it turns out that they lay their eggs up on top of rocks above water, and the tadpoles hatch and slide down the rock into the water. And I was lucky enough just to have my camera the night that we found that. So here's some additional tips on photography, I guess. Here's a snake that is mildly venomous, and someone brought it to us and handed it to me by the head. And I usually don't handle venomous snakes with my hands, but the gentleman who brought it to us had it in his hand and handed it to me, and that was the only thing I could do. So we captured the snake. We went ahead and euthanized it because I didn't like to have this this venomous snake in my hands. And with some reptiles, you can actually pose them after death and get a natural looking photograph that encapsulates what it looks like when you see it in the life. So this is, I don't recommend dead reptile pose photography, but if it's the only thing you can do for a rare species, you can get a picture that looks fairly lifelike. But we also take pictures of them, you know, next to something of scale with the tag that we're going to put on the specimen there and photograph them, so we have the documentation of the animal and the tag, the catalog number that goes with that live photograph. Keep going. And then we just like to have lots of photographs of animals in these posed areas. So we set up a little studio, like a rock with some branches and leaves behind it and things like that, so we can get a natural, you know, semi-natural looking photograph and take pictures of, in this case, a frog, an agamid lizard, another flying lizard. Here's one of these little toadlets that are actually potentially related to some of the small species of toads here in Africa. Another one of those Asian-African convergences on morphology and miniaturized toadlet. Go ahead, a Sicilian, a tree frog. So we'd like to get lots of natural photographs because those are what people want for field guides and things like that. Snakes are another business. We'll talk again more about this when we talk about data tomorrow, but snakes that are non-venomous, like this one here, are not a problem because you can set up a studio area with branches and some background and get decent photographs of them. I'm almost done here. Go ahead. And then the next one, well, venomous snakes are really tricky. And as a full-time herpetologist, I don't like to handle venomous snakes with my hands ever. And I think the general public thinks that herpetologists like to catch venomous snakes because they see that on TV and hold them by the tail and, you know, and wrangle them. I don't recommend that at all. And it was when working with serious snake biologists that I learned that you can handle them with sticks and with bags very carefully, and you never really have to touch them with your hands. So that's sort of my rule. So to get a photograph of it like this of a pit viper, next one, here's a picture of me. What I do is take the animal with a snake stick or something like that. In this case, the river was right there, and I was able to take the animal take it over to the cold water, put it in the river, let it swim around, and tire itself out till it's calmed down and is settled down, and then we can pose it and get a photograph of it like I just showed you. Next one, almost there. So when it comes to venomous reptiles, again, I really want to emphasize that we don't take any risks at all, and so we keep them in bags that we hang up in the camp separately, and we keep them in plastic bags so you can see what's in that bag. You know, I don't like to have venomous reptiles in a cloth bag where you can't see where the head is and see what species is in there. So I always recommend separating venomous reptiles from all the others so that we don't have any mistakes. And I also want to emphasize that even if it's a non-venomous snake, these are big animals. This is a python. And even if it's a non-venomous snake, it can hurt you. So you don't want to get bitten on the hand by a turtle, you know, that can really damage you, or on the leg by a python. This is a graduate student that Town and I co-advise, who got a little too close and was a little careless around a big python, and this is, she's pretty tough. We're really proud of her for being pretty tough in the field. You can even see the teeth of the python that's left in the skin right there. Yeah, I was pretty impressed. Anyway, okay, zooming ahead, and then the last thing I want to emphasize that often when it comes to particular populations. I've talked a lot about how we sample and preserve them, but there are some populations where you're not going to want to, or you don't really have a reason to preserve the specimens. And in this instance, this is a tree frog that is occurring in decreasing in populations of decline that appear to be in decline in the Philippines. And we've already been to this population and sampled, so we already have some genetic material, but we still want to go back once a year, or once every couple years, and sample the population and see how it's doing. Sample it in terms of estimate the numbers of individuals in this particular area. And this is a high elevation pool breeding tree frog in the Philippines. And so it's a really beautiful species, and so we're really carefully monitoring its population. And we visit it a couple times, and we take chytrid samples from it. Go ahead, next one. And are just checking the intensity of chytrid infections in this population and then letting the individuals go. So you might want to, for some of the survey methods in particular areas, you might not need to collect specimens if it's particularly rare, if it's already been sampled, if it's already been documented in that area. there are instances where, of course, where you're not going to want to preserve the specimen, and I always want to emphasize that point because it's not just about collecting as many objects as possible. And then I also want to make the point that when you do have that preserved specimen, here's another case of a Varanus lizard that looks pretty lifelike, right? Nope, this is one that actually was killed by dogs in a nearby village, and the farmer brought us this individual. But you know, if you sort of pose it right and lift the head up, you can get a picture that looks semi-lifelike, and make the best of a less than ideal situation, and actually get some decent photographs of it. But in the process, in this one, we're also sampling all these animals for parasites, and big reptiles like this often have lots of ectoparasites, like ticks and mites. And so these students here are taking ectoparasites and then liver sample parasites from inside this animal as well. So even a salvage situation where someone brings you a dead animal, there's lots of information, lots of data that you'll want to collect. Go ahead. And then just towards the end of the process, we're going to talk a lot more about types of data, but at the end of a long survey effort like this, we're making species lists per day, we're making species per particular habitat types, and then a final species list of every taxon that we've recorded, and making an indication in our notes about whether we photographed that animal in life, and whether the frogs, each of their voices were recorded. So we have this complete record of the existence of them, and then what type of ancillary data supports it. And then we have, here's just an example of one of our master species lists at the end of one of these sites where we're just recording every species that we can. And you'll see a lot of these unidentified things, Phalaudis species 2, for example. We don't even know at this point what some of these species are, but we're just trying to make sure that we make documentation of each of the different kind or the different class of species that's there. And we know how many of individuals we've collected. And then our final product is to sort of come up with a big table here. And I just want to show you the elements of how we do one of these final sort of attempt at a faunal inventory. These are the list of species here organized by family. We have the different surrounding areas, the different provinces that surround the focal area that we were really focused on, and whether or not there's been records of those species. And in this case, we've coded the species that represent new records with an N, and the H represent species that are historical records from past work or ancillary collections where ornithologists have caught that or recorded that in the past. And so we've organized all the species by families, and we'll just scroll down this table. And here we are, all the diversity in this group, literally every family of amphibian, every family of reptile, listing by species, indicating whether it has a historical record or a new species record. And then the end product is a publication, and this is one that's just an attempt at an inventory of this whole this small province in the northern Philippines, where we have literally tried to record the presence of every single species that we could. And the goal was just to have as complete an inventory and convince ourselves that for one of these sites, we have recorded everything that's there. And this one, you can see, there's 20 localities, which means different habitat types. 20 different habitat types within this forest. And we record the presence of a total of 58 amphibian and reptile species, which is not particularly diverse, especially for some areas like here in Cameroon, where the diversity may go as high as 80 or 90 species in a really rich site. But for this area, which is farther north, it's more temperate, that's pretty high diversity. And I was particularly pleased with this study because we reached what I thought was going to be a reasonable amount of diversity in a matter of 2.5 or 3 weeks by just exhaustively going after the fauna and documenting everything that was there. So let's stop here, and then I want to show you, sorry about this, Kate, I'm going to move out of the camera here. I just want to show you that final publication. And we'll, of course, make this available in the Dropbox. If we just go through this, I just want to show you, to prove to you that literally, you know, all that information that we collected, all that information is included in here. All those photographs that I took while hiking up the mountain, all those images that I took of each of the habitat types in the forest, they're all included. Every one of those is a figure in this paper. So we're literally, like, as we're going through the process of doing these surveys, we're thinking about this publication and thinking about the final product and how we're going to represent this and making sure that we get good photographs of everything, because every one of those distinct habitat types or distinct views of the mountain or distinct views of the landscape, every one of those is going to be a figure in this paper and is going to show you the differences between the different habitat types. A high elevation forest with a stream at the top, or a spring that comes out of a dry area, or a dry ridge up in the forest. Each of those areas have distinct species of amphibians that you won't find in the other areas. The cloud forest when we get to the top of the mountain, agricultural areas down below, And then we go species by species. And here's those same elements that I just showed you. The habitat of these species, each species of frog, the ones that have direct development that I took pictures of the froglets on a white background. All that information we want to have included here. And then, you know, if you've taken a photograph, a decent photograph of every species that you encountered, every one of those can go into the paper and be a separate figure. And in the time when you're tired in the field, when you're doing lots of collecting, it's kind of hard to remind yourself, like, did we photograph that species yet? You know, have we gotten a photograph of every species of frog, each species of lizard, all the snakes that are in there? Have we actually taken the time to photograph every single one of them? But if you do, they all go into this into these papers and become this great source. And there's our table at the end, as in a big appendix at the end of the whole paper. I like to have all that stuff in there because I think every bit of that information is going to help someone down the road. Every one of those images, all those habitat definitions, all the table at the end, all that's going to be a great resource for students or biologists or wildlife managers or ecotourists or all the people who are going to want to come here to Mount Cameroon and see and learn something about the diversity. This serves as like a field guide to that particular area. And in fact, when people have told me, oh, we got a copy of your paper and it's great, we use it as a field guide to the protected area behind us, behind our university, that makes me really happy. Because these resources, the end product, can be really helpful for researchers in the future. So I'm going to stop there, and we're going to talk about a whole different sources of types of data tomorrow, and we'll focus on different ways of monitoring or different ways of recording the existence of the species. But I just wanted to go through that whole process because to make the point that if you do it as thoroughly as possible, and if you try to record every bit of information that you can along the way, you can produce a really nice product that can be really helpful to people who come and want to learn something about the biodiversity, the people who come after you to a particular area like this. So. Mm-hmm.